Morning, guys. John Rock at TV1 here. And it is a balmy 29 degrees out here in my garage. So, because I'm cheap, I'm heating the place with my Stirling engine with a 54-inch fan. Today's project is fixed milling vices. This is my 626 Harbor Freight milling machine, and we will do it with a homemade fly cutter. We're going to work on this a couple of years ago. I made a video about the 100 size cross-slide XY vice from like Harbor Freight or your local Chi-Com store, and how poorly made they are. However, if you consider what it is as just a casting, maybe we can make something out of it. Let me show you the setup. This is my homemade cutter, and you can see that is a sizable chunk of tool steel in there. And we will run this at something around 200 RPM, and that's all. That's about as slow as I can make this machine go, maybe a little slower if I run the belt up crooked to the smallest pulley, which I don't really care. I do it when I have to. We eat the bells up, we put new ones on. But yeah, this is made right here on this milling machine with a half inch end mill, and we sent down through there with a brand spanking new Lindex new old stock collar that, while this was made in Japan and not made in the US, I did pay $10 for it out of the schwank rack at my surplus store. And $10 for, I believe, you know, the Japanese guys, you know, you could say whatever you want about them, but they've been making, like samurai swords out of steel for thousands of years. So I kind of figured that it's pretty good quality stuff, and it's got to be at least as good as those, you know, $112 collet sets that you can buy these days for $15 or whatever. And it adds up about the same. So I was pretty happy to give my local guy $10 for a couple of these brand new ones. Found a couple of three quarters in there and a couple of other ones, and hey, I'm happy with them, because that thing didn't run out. That tool steel fits in there like it was supposed to be part of that original. No run out in there. So, you know, while that may be a half inch end mill, it probably measures about, you know, 499 and a half. And then where you throw in a thou or a thou and a half of run out coming down through. And so that slot, I didn't have to measure it with anything but the tool steel. And that's how I do it. I measure with the part that's supposed to fit. Yes, sir. Just like when I made the end here, that fits with the same number as, that's a three quarters for a three quarter collet, and she measures right in at 750 and a couple of tenths. So that's a nice fit. You can, if you don't have plug gauges, you can check them with the backside of your end mill. Do use a tenth micrometer to check your end mills, and make sure you keep them clean and burr free when you put them in your collets. Same thing about your collets. Keep your collets clean and burr free when you put them in your spindle. Yes, sir. Okay, so hopefully you can see that all right on there with the light bulb. that is a 6-inch vise, and you can see these here from the mill cutter that went across there. And of course, he stopped when it hit the hot jaw. It just probably stalled the machine out or started smoking a belt or something right there. Stopped the cutter. I don't know who did that. It looks like a chisel or something. However, I don't know if you could see the surface finish on these, but by using a parallel and a 1,000 feeler gauge, you can't get under it at all, anywhere, on here. And it's perfect, as far as I'm concerned. It's way nicer for me. I can actually chuck a part in here now and not worry about it, pulling up, because there was 2,000 missing somewhere on my thing. I had just enough to clean these up above the bolt heads. And if I had to, I would scoff these bolt heads down. You can buy new jaws. There's a guy on eBay selling them. They're American-made machinable jaws. However, if I need those, I will make some myself, because I'm cheap. Yeah, and I can. So today's project is try out this here cutter and the grind that I have on here. You can see what I needed to cover this vise, which is what this is actually for. Is I needed to be able to cover 6 inches. So this is why we made this cutter. This one here is good to about 3.5. So I was able to lock these jaws up in here and do them, flip them, get them on parallels, do them, put them back, and fix the running faces of these. I did not do the faces that are against the jaw, against the vise itself, and trying to keep the thing parallel and square. And so it came out very well. And you can, if you sharpen these right, cut hardened steel with these, making blue chips and not sparks. You know, once in a while, if you get it, when you get down to your last half a thousand or something like this, and if you're shopping these right, it will cut a half a thousand. Today's first project is we are going to do the base of that cross-slide vise, because she is some cattywampus down here. She don't sit flat on nothing. And now that I have a milling machine, I don't know that I actually need this, but we're going to use it for a test part, and I wanted to clean up the bottom of that. And I needed something bigger than a 3-inch, because I want to cover the whole swing with one tool. I don't want to leave any ridges on there. And this is a good test of the tram of your machine. Excuse me. By doing stuff like this, you can actually, you know, you can tram and indicate till the cows come home on your machine going, is my machine square, and oh, my lady's cutting the taper, and all stuff like that. And the best thing you can really do is go ahead and make a part. Okay, guys, so hopefully you can see that all right. There's my homemade blind cutter, my half-inch tool bit, homie ground. I use the angles that were already built into the tool steel, so that I didn't have to hardly grind any. I don't know if you can actually see that grind on there. But yeah, and that's my whole point, because I'm cheap, is only remove the amount of tool steel that I need to remove. And yeah, that'll be like a dedicated cutter for that particular thing. And I used two techniques when I was sharpening this. I have already sort of weaned myself off of using the radius of the wheel. Excuse me, and that is because it doesn't lend itself to my square stone to finish the honing on my tools, which I do like to do. So I got like flat hair and flat underneath, and then I got a roundy over here, and I put a little bit of a radius on the nose, and yeah, I'm not sure I like it. So we'll see how this cut. However, this thing is in here with, you know, the best measurement tools that I could come up with. And it's on a set of cheap parallels, which I know are, while they are parallel to, you know, I think the cheap Harbor Freight, you know, the cheap Chinese ones that you can get, they say they're 2/10 over 6 inches. However, they don't pair them hardly within 1,000. So guess what? But that would even still be close enough on this job. But even the ways on this are no good. So I got to pick a happy medium, and that's about what we did. As far as I know, we could probably be taking a cotter wrench off the back side of this over here. But we're going to find out. Okay, hopefully this paper's coming out all right by there, and I'm not losing myself here. If I am, well, you won't see this if this tape don't work right, because my camera's on the on its outgoing leg there. After 2000, since 2007, I've been using this rig, so maybe it's time for a fresh one. So I don't know which one to get, you know? But, okay. So, I like to do everything as short and close to the spindle as possible. All right, you can see that's one hell of a tool out there, hanging all the hell out there. So you gotta make sure that you're not gonna crunch nothing. And I've already saw the look. I like to stand on the right side of the machine, over here, and the tool is ground so that I can feed the pot into it this way. And it's also centered on the part, and the tool is just makes it by the side on both sides. That way I can feed the pot into the tool and then wind it back and feed up with my knee. This is a knee mill, and I like to use the knee to feed with, because once you start learning how to do that, you just keep the quill locked and you don't worry about nothing going on in there, no movement, no vibration in the machine or whatever. So I get close with my knee here, and I bring to the edge of the pot, get close, and then on every cut, we will lock the knee up, because it will make it suck towards the machine, and the back weighs about a thou on the front. So I do try to tighten that up as long as I'm remembering on every cut. Okay. So hopefully I'm not wearing myself here. I'm on the fine feed of the quill, and I'm just gonna give it some until she begins to cook that pot. Hopefully you guys are seeing that. I'm trying to stay out of the way and not hurt myself with that shank and cutter out there. Should be getting close now. So as soon as she touches the pot, we are going to run by the whole thing and make sure that She's not 10 miles up in the air on a far corner, because that would, you know what I mean? We don't want to feed nothing to it yet until we find out what's cooking. Okay, I don't know if you're hearing that, but I have just made contact, and I'm locking my quill. Okay? That's all I'm going to do with the 5 feet on the machine. That's it. Done. Lock the quill up. Now we're going to come feed the pot to the... Feed the cutter to the pot, or the pot to the cutter. However you want to say it. And you got to go slow, because that's a big-ass cutter, and you don't want to find... You're up an eighth of an inch somewhere on your initial pass. You just don't want to find that. So already we're cutting. Hopefully you guys are seeing this all right. Oh, homie, drum cutter is working. She is up into an inch, a three-quarter inch, call it, an inch and a half. And we are running at about somewhere between 2.25 and 250 RPM. I don't know, the belt settings on this don't give you this setting. I'm running on an extra setting up in there. By running the belt a little cattywampus up to the other pulley, which works. I like to cover up. I get it with the vacuum. Cover up. No exposed screws anywhere if I can stand it. The guys that have these machines, the 626 machines, Grizzly, the Harbor Freight, when you tighten your collet in, these spindle splines on these machines rattle like some greased pig running around the farm. They just don't fit. Eventually, my machine is already a year and a half old, so it's out of warranty. However, I did not want to play with some woman on the phone that don't know what I'm talking about. I don't have time for it. And I also don't have time to take this machine apart 5 or 6 times while they send me more parts made from the same place that ain't gonna fit. So I will make my own in my own good time. You guys subscribe, keep watching, you'll see that. I can't say when, because we're still getting tooled up to make gears for the Logan. I love that old girl. This job right here is one of those good ones for a power feed. However, I don't have one. Yep, she's taking a whole mile off the backside. Not as much on the front. Half a mile. Oh, yeah. It's just fun. So I'm feeding this right to it with no real concern for surface finish at this point, because we're going to go back the other way. And all we need to do is hit all the corners, and that's it. I'm going to take off as little as possible, and that's the gig. And see what kind of surface finish we can get out of that tool. This is cast iron, and I want to use this same tool on this vise to clean them scabs off the top so that I can feel better about looking at my vise. Just tip the corner back there on that backside. What'd that look like? Almost got out that little Nicaroni there that was in there from the fracture on this side. But most of that's gone missing. And for the most part, she's flat now. So, yeah. I could probably play with this all day. However, it was a $40 vise to begin with, or $35, whatever I paid for it, which was far too much. And we're just playing with it at this point. So, hey, thanks for watching.